Today's video adds to a series of videos I've done on MICC cable, mineral insulated copper clad cable, sometimes called MI cable, and sometimes on site actually called Pyro cable. Pyro Tanax actually make mineral insulated copper clad cable. So in the other videos in this series, I've shown you how to strip MI cable. I've shown you how to put the end onto an MI cable, in other words, seal the end and explain why you have to do that. And then I've gone on and also tested it and identified the ends. You can see this is a really old one I've got in my set. It's identified red and black. Obviously, we'd be identifying it now blue and brown, but that's an old one. We're going to look at the tools and the ends and the seals, etc., that we need to be able to identify, because in some of our exams, it's a simple case of just being shown a tool as an image and then having to identify in a multi-choice exam. It also links nicely to those other three videos that I've made on mineral insulated cable. So let's start off with probably the tool you're going to use most in college, maybe when stripping the ends of it. This is a joy stripper. As I bring it in here, you can see the barrel on the end has a series of holes, and against the barrel we have things like 2L1.5. So we need to know what that means. So 2L1.5, I bring it in a mineral insulated cable here. We'll use the same process here. So we said two. Two in this case is the number of conductors. You're gonna have considerably more than two conductors. The likelihood at college you'll be working with either a two or a three core mineral insulated cable. So two, the next was L. L stands for light gauge. So the actual copper cladding here, which is often used as our circuit protective conductor, in this case is of a light gauge. It can be thicker and can be a heavy gauge. I've never used heavy gauge, but it is solid drawn. So in other words, that's a solid copper outer sheath on this cable, which means actually bare mineral insulated cable could be laid in water, not the ends. We'll talk about that in other videos about keeping moisture out from the ends. You can submerge this end, but believe it or not, the cable itself can be submerged. So two conductors, L, light gauge, and then this one here on the barrel said 1.5. That's the conductor size. Actually, this one here would be 1 mil. So this would be 2L1 for 1 millimeter squared. So if we have a look on the barrel here, see if I can find it. So what we've got there is 2L1. So two core, light gauge, 1 mil. So we'd have to use the appropriate hole in the joy stripper in order to strip our mineral insulated copper clad cable. Also, there's a little blade in there. So you can see a little blade, and it's important that that blade is in the correct position. Again, I recommend you ask your instructor when you get stuck stripping mineral insulated cable to actually confirm the blade is in the right place. And again, in the video where I show and terminate them, I'll explain that once again. So that was our joy stripper. Another way of stripping mineral insulated cable is using this rotary stripper here. Has like a little vise or clamp on it. So you can screw down onto the cable itself that sits in there. And that is the blade. There's a spare blade here on the actual back of it as well. And again, I've shown a technique of using this type of rotary stripper in order to strip off the outer copper cladding of mineral insulated cable. So joy stripper and rotary stripper. There's another stripping tool here that students tend to shy away with. Hopefully at your college you'll get an opportunity to use one of these. This is a key stripper. So if you're a slightly older person and watching this video, you might remember these on the side of a tin of corned beef or Spam, and they're used to wind round and strip the cable. The beauty of these ones is there is no blade and they can do any size that you want. This rotary stripper, they do them in different sizes depending on the mineral insulated cable, so they get bigger and bigger as you go. This one here can do any size of mineral insulated cable and hasn't got a blade in it, it goes blunt. And I do show you in one of my videos how to use this along with our ringing tool, so similar to what our plumbers use for ringing round copper pipe and breaking it off. There's a slightly larger one. You have to use a ringing tool along with our key stripper in order to strip our mineral insulated cables. And my students all get a go with the key stripper. I think it's important that you have a go with that, because I think you could make one of these up on site if you were struggling. You'd left these at home in order to strip the ends of mineral insulated cable. So that's a key stripper. We've got our ringing tools. Okay, in other words, just a blade and a rotary motion. So again, the picture in exam might look slightly different. That gives us our three stripping tools that we've got to be able to identify. We've got this here, which is our crimping tool. And I show this in my videos when I put my pot in and I look to seal it and how important it is to seal the ends of a pot to prevent the ingress of moisture, because that can cause the end to go down. So this crimping tool is wound down and squashes the disc and the pot together, which I'll show you later in the presentation when it's full of compound and it squirts it out. And we've got this here, which clamps onto the pot and works like a little vise in order that you can screw your pot on. So that's a potting tool. That's a crimping tool. It's important we can identify those for multi-choice exams. And in other videos, I'll show you exactly how to use them. If we look at our cables themselves, they can come bare. So in this case, we've got a PVC sheath on it. So you could have a bare mineral insulated cable. We've got, obviously, on this one, a red outer sheath. The red outer sheath would be used for a fire alarm circuit. And again, that can be a multi-choice question. A cable identified with a red outer PVC sheathing is likely to be used for, and that would be a fire alarm circuit. We've also got white. So mineral insulated covered with a white outer PVC sheathing. And the white outer PVC sheathing would suggest in an installation that that is a emergency lighting circuit. So again, an exam question could say a white cable feeding a lighting circuit, the light fittings are likely to be of what type? There'd be emergency light fittings, so emergency lighting. Orange, hopefully you remember that the standard color for an electrical circuit is orange. In my previous workshop, we had all our conduit systems actually painted orange to identify it as a electrical circuit. So we can see the orange outer PVC sheathing here. It links to other things like if you saw a blue pipe, it would be full of water. If you saw a yellow pipe, it'd be full of gas. If you saw an orange, and sometimes you see this in ducting by the side of the road, and when roundabouts are being refurbished, etc., you see an orange ducting. It's actually electrical colour is identified by orange. So they're worth remembering those colours. White's emergency lighting, red's for fire alarm, orange the general colour for electrical systems, and you can also have mineral insulated cable bare. Let's have a look at some of the bits that make up the gland. So if I bring this one in here, you can see this one here was a 7-core, 1mm 7-core for this one. Unfortunately, one of the students over the years, I've had this, you know, 20 years, has broken one of the conductors off. So if you're keen-eyed, you probably see six there. But if you look at it side on, we've got our gland nut, half, which you can't really see here, half of a compression olive, which I'll show you in a minute. The rest of the gland body, we've got the pot, and the pot this time, you can see the conductors in there would be filled with compound, and a disc and cap onto the top of it. So that is our breakdown of our gland. So that's a gland nut, the gland body, compression olive, the compound would sit in here, and a disc or cap on the top. So let's see those elements. So we first of all bring in a gland body, and like with the stripping tool, when we use the joy stripper, you need to identify on it what conductors gauge and number of those conductors. So I'll try and see if I can see it with my terrible eyes. I don't think you're gonna be able to see it, but it, on the side here, it actually says the following. Let's have a look. It says 2L1. So on the side of that, it says 2L1. So this must be used in conjunction with the cable I showed you at the start, which was 2-core, 1mm, and it was light gauge. And if we break it down, we've got our gland nut here, so we take off our gland nut. This was hard to see, if you can see at all. That's our compression olive, and that squeezes against the outer metal clad of our cable to compress onto it to make a really fantastic connection to what will be our circuit protective conductor, our earth connection on the outer metal cladding. So that's our compression olive, and this is our gland body. So there are elements there. So gland nut, gland body, and compression olive. Often in colleges, they don't allow you to use the compression olive because once you've squeezed it at once, it has to be thrown away. So once you've used a pack of 10, once through, obviously the compression olives will now be missing. So often you don't get a chance at college to put those in. But if you're installing them in the real world, make sure you install your compression olive. That brings us to the pots. So if I open up this bag here, we've got our oversleeving, which is black and can be identified blue and brown or whatever colours are required. We've got our compound, which goes inside of our pot. It always looks a bit like some sort of plasticine. So as we look there, we've got this compound. It's important that you don't put it onto a bench maybe where there's metal filings, etc., because you don't want to get that in and then punch that into the pot to seal it. So this will prevent the ingress of moisture into our pot. So when we come back here and we see this section here where we can see the conductors, that's the area we fill up with our compound, and I've showed that in a previous video. So compound, and again, you should be able to get about three ends out of that. Students often try and just get one out of it and then chuck it away. You only get three sticks in order to do 10 ends. So you've got to be doing at least three with each of the compounds. And then we've got the pot itself. We'll get these out, and the disc. And again, we'd have to make sure they're appropriately the right size. So if we bring this one down here again, I don't think you're gonna be able to see it. That one is 2L1.5. It's got a little thread inside there that taps onto the cable. So that taps onto the cable and held securely in place. And again, in my video, I'll show you that. And then we've got a disc from my two conductors. So that goes on the top. So the compound goes into here. It's squashed up using our crimping tool, and we squeeze on the end of there to seal our end. So if I bring this one in, you can see that the pot here is actually filled full of compound. You see some compound on the outside still. The disc this time is white. Oh, well, I've just shown you is black. And the inside there is the compound squeezed into place, and that's held onto there. And we've got our two conductors. And the outer part here would be our circuit protective conductor. We'd obviously have the rest of the gland body going onto there. So if we bring this one in, this one's got a slightly different, we'll have a look at the pot in a minute, because that's actually got a CPC. Now that CPC could be one of the conductors, but it's unlikely because there's so much copper on the outside of mineral insulated cable that we're gonna use that. So this is actually what we call an earth tail pot. So we open this up, we see the gland nut. We've got a compression olive in there that's been held into place and squeezed up. So that one's held. So when we tighten that down like so, it crushes that olive. And you can see when we take off the gland nut, the gland body stays in place and it crimps against the outer CPC. And we've got our two conductors in old colours. So we would see them now as brown and as blue, whereas currently we're red and black. Shows how old Gary's kit is that he's got for visual display in college. We talked about an earth tail pot. These are here, our earth tail pots. So again, if I look on the side, it will tell me, and I'll have a look, this is 2L1, so two core, light gauge, 1mm², which is this one here. But you can see we've now got an additional welded into it, a fly lead. So we get a brilliant electrical connection off the pot. And I said the pot would be screwed onto the mineral insulated cable. That screwing on process will make a good connection. And the compression olive, that we've got this tail now coming out, which becomes our circuit protective conductor, rather than relying just on the body here. So we could be relying on just that body. So if we didn't have the earth tail in, we'd be relying on the connection through pushing it into a metallic box and tightening it off to make our electrical connection through to our CPC. So that's our earth tail pot. We've got things like shrouds. Again, we use these in armored cable. We're used to seeing a shroud on it. If you've got bare MI cable, often there is no shroud. There's no need for one. But once we start having PVC insulated ones, red, white, orange, we can use a shroud to cover up. So if we come in here, that would slide over there in order that we can obviously make it look a little bit neater. The shroud will match the color of the mineral insulated cable, whether it be red, whether it be orange or white. As we go through, we can fasten our mineral insulated cables to the surface. We can fasten it using things like this. These are actually straps of copper. So if I took all this outside orange PVC off, it would just be copper. So, and that's there, and that's called a P-clip. And that wraps around the cable and then is held in with a screw. So we take it around our cable and we just squeeze it up, and then that's fixed into position. So we put a screw through there in order to hold it. Often the screws I used on my college were these ones. There were black Japan screws, but you can use the screws that are required from your college. But again, might be worth noting the type of head on there, and they are slotted, which makes them a little bit more tricky, but these are black Japan screws and they're often used alongside mineral insulated cables. Got here some compound. This is a petroleum jelly in order to make it easier to do the stripping process. And in my videos where I terminate the ends, you'll see me apply a little bit of this. It makes it easier where you've got a blade to run it down the cable in order to help the cutting process. So again, this blade here is made a little bit easier if you've got, effectively it's Vaseline, but that's obviously a trade name. It's petroleum jelly, just a little bit of a lubricant to help the stripping process. We've got these clips here, which are from a different style of clips. You could use these. These are Linian fire clips, and they drill a hole in the surface and they're pushed into place. They don't require a screw. So when you're thinking about premature collapse in the wiring system, we look to remove maybe plastic plugs and screws to make it an even better fixing. But these are Linian fire clips, again, white, red, and can be used for mineral insulated cable. The one I've been leaving, hopefully you've spotted it on the table. This is my straightening tool for MI. I recommend for mineral insulated cable that you actually wind it off the drum really neatly. So when you're taking it off at college, wind it off neatly so it stays as straight and as flat as possible. But on site where you've pulled in loads and loads of cable, often it has little kinks in it. So it could just be a little bit kinky. So if we just pull this P-clip out of the way, I'll show you how the straightening tool works. They can look different in exam pictures. It's a series of wheels at which we run the cable over it, and it should take out mild kinks. Really sharp bends in it, it won't remove. You can also use a wooden block and a plastic headed hammer, believe it or not, in order just to tap these out by putting the wooden block one side and tapping it with a hammer on the other. Let's see if I can show how the straightening tool works. So it goes in, it's held into position. Mine is really old. See if I can get the clips to come down. Spin that round. That is old, Gaz. So in we go, clip it into place. And then what you end up doing is just running the wheels through. So as you hold on to it, you're going to pull the cable backwards and forwards through it. Backwards and forwards through it in order that you can straighten that out. So if I pull that through, and then pull it out the end. Hopefully you can see that's a lot straighter maybe than it was to start with. Obviously it's really old, a bit like Gaz. So that's straightened out. So you often see in exams pictures of something with a couple of three rotating wheels and a handheld device. That would be a MI cable straightening tool. So that's a whistle stop tour of the items that you may be asked under examination conditions to identify from a picture. So that's the tools we looked at, the breakdown of the gland body, compression olive, etc. All the other stuff I've covered whilst I'm terminating the cables. So again, I recommend you check out those videos in this series of mineral insulated cables.